You're welcome to this edition of The Inside on Equinox Television. I am Bible Jonathan. The United States of America and the European Union are piling pressure on the Cameroon government over the deepening Anglophone crisis and the arrest and detention of the national president of the CRM political party, Professor Maurice KAMTO. Other leaders of that party and over 200 militants who have been detained in different incarceration centers in the nation's political capital, Yaoundé. In a recent statement, EU representative Federica Mogherini described the deepening crisis in the northwest and southwest regions as unacceptable, notably referring to the increasing number of casualties and the heavy impact on human life and, of course, the socio-economic state of the two Anglophone regions of the country. And in the same vein, U.S. Undersecretary of State for African Affairs Thibault Nagy urged the Cameroon government to be more serious in the management of the socio-political and security crisis in the northwest and southwest regions of the country, indicating that the measures taken so far by the Cameroon government are insufficient to solve the crisis. Both officials, speaking on behalf of the United States and the European Union, urged the BIA governments to release Professor Maurice KAMTO and other supporters of the CRM political party. In the meantime, the Nigerian Federal High Court has called on the government of Nigeria to bring back SISIKU, AYUK, TABE, the other nine leaders of the Anglophone struggle to Nigeria. But will this yield any fruits? And of course, we're going to be looking at this and the trial that has continued at the Yaoundé military court. Stay with us and meet our guest in some few seconds. Our guest in this edition of the program is a senior legal mind, the lead defense counsel of SISIKU, AYUK, TABE, and the other nine Anglophone leaders being detained in Cameroon's political capital, Yaoundé, in connection to the deepening Anglophone crisis. Barrister FRU, you're welcome.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, sir.
Were you surprised when you heard that Barrister Michel Ndoki of the CRM political party was transferred to the Kondengi maximum security prison in Yaoundé?
I was not surprised. She met us when we were still in court in the military tribunal. She came to the military tribunal. I knew that they were going to charge her and remand her to prison, because that is the modus operandi that this regime is using to fight its political opponents. And they've transformed the military court into a political court. So I wasn't surprised when they brought her, and she's now in the principal prison, the same prison where my clients, AYUK, TABE, and nine others, and our clients, AYUK, TABE, and nine others, and the most eminent professor, Maurice KAMTO, they're all in that principal prison. So that prison is looking like a political prison now.
As a legal mind, what's your analysis of the legal backings that have been advanced by government to arrest and detain these political leaders, Professor Maurice KAMTO and the others?
There's no legal backing. You know, the laws of 1990, they provide for public manifestation, public meetings, or want to hold a manifestation, you declare, and when you declare, you declare to the sous-préfet, not to the prefect, I must add, and
the divisional officer
will issue if he thinks that the itinerary that you want to match is not conducive because of one problem or other, he has a right to change the itinerary. But he has no right systematically to refuse, claiming that it will engender public peace, because that's the language they use to refuse manifestation for the opposition parties. But when it comes to the ruling party, oh no, everybody marches, everybody dances in the street, everybody does what it does. So there is no legal backing.
To have
transformed a violation, which they call a violation of public manifestations, to terrorism charges and transfer the case to the military tribunal. It's a as we saw it coming when they passed the law on suppression of terrorism in 2014. That law, Mr. Bia, was meant for Mr. Bia to clamp on all political opponents in the country, and that is what is happening right now. So they have transformed that now to when you march now, they will now frame up all those charges and say that you are rebelling against the state, you are fighting against the state, you have called for rebellion, you have called for this, and transform it into terrorism, and then charge you for terrorism and send you to the military court.
But in response to international pressure, the spokesperson of the Cameroon government, the Minister of Communication, René Manuel Sade, said these political leaders were arrested within the ambit of the law.
If they were arrested within the ambit of the law, they should apply the 1990 laws. But that's not what the law they're applying. They are now pushing it now to apply the 2014 terrorism law on people who were marching peacefully. They were even shot at by the police. So it's neither here nor there. I don't see how you can transform a public manifestation, which is a right enshrined in the Constitution, to terrorism violations of terrorism law of 2014. That is why everybody now, if you are caught just holding a meeting, they will transform it now into terrorism and send you to the military court, and from there to Kondenge, and they try you under the military court, which has a maximum penalty of death. I don't understand it.
Even though it's been repeatedly said by officials of the CRM political party and other persons, civil society leaders and so on, that there was no destruction in the national territory as far as the strike action of the 26th of January in some major towns of the country is concerned, but there was some destruction in some embassies in Paris and in Germany, and these destructions have been attributed to Maurice KAMTO and others, and of course the CRM political party.
I don't know whether these people take Cameroonians for fools. Something happened in Cameroon, the March of the 26th. There was no destruction, there was nothing, it was peaceful march. And whatever took place in France or wherever, it is, how do you stay in Cameroon and commit a crime in France to the extent that you destroy an embassy? The people who destroyed an embassy in France and maybe, what is it,
Germany,
had nothing to do with the Renaissance Party here in Cameroon. I watch the news too. They call them Brigade Anti-Sardina. How is that connected to a political party in Cameroon? I don't understand it. You sit in Cameroon, okay, the law, the crime was committed where? In France. France is a country. It has its own laws. It's a sovereign nation. They have a right to arrest and charge anybody who misbehaves in France. Well, how is that connected to Cameroon? How is that connected to a manifestation, a public manifestation in Cameroon?
No, this
it's just to give a dog a bad name, to hang it.
Now, there is, in one of the charges leveled against Professor Maurice KAMTO, there is hostility against the fatherland. What is it, hostilities against the fatherland?
That is coined exactly from the terrorism law. There is nothing like that in the 1990 laws and the laws on public expression, public manifestation, which is even enshrined in the Constitution. It's your basic right, except that it is controlled by the 1990 laws, and it is under the control and supervision of the divisional officers in the whole country. So I don't see how that charge that you just read is connected to public manifestations. I don't see it.
Some argue that, like I listened to the first vice president of the CRM political party,
yes,
Amadou Mouta.
Mr. Mouta.
He said hostility against the fatherland means Nigeria or another nation attacks your country. Nigeria, for example, Chad, for example, or the Central African Republic attacks Cameroon, and you, a Cameroonian, you take side with the foreigners.
That is exactly what it is. But the drafters of that 2014 law on terrorism never thought of that. How can a Cameroonian acting within his constitutional rights be hostile to his country? How is that possible? You can only be hostile to your country if you take sides with a foreign nation against your country. But if you are, as an individual or a group of individuals, marching down the streets of your country, how are you hostile to your country?
What about actions that threatened public peace, the stability of the nation?
Let me tell you, the 1990 law.
Because these are some of the issues that have been highlighted to justify those charges against
Maurice KAMTO. Let me tell you, the 1990 law is clear. Public manifestations are regulated by the divisional officers. He can even call police to guard the people who are marching so that there will be no destruction. And effectively, on the 26th of January, in the whole country, where they arrested all these people and brought to Yaoundé, there was no destruction anywhere. In fact, a violation came from the forces of law and order, the police. You are not supposed to, during public manifestation, use firearm. But that's what they did. They used firearm and shot on some of these militants and wounded them. These people never destroyed anything. How is that a violation? All these things, they are doing it to coin it under the 2014 law on suppression of terrorism. That was the legislative intent, now we are knowing, of that law, to cram down on all political opponents in Cameroon.
And that is why probably the CRM political party is accusing the BR regime of putting in place a criminal plan. That's how the vice president of the party puts it, a criminal plan to destroy the CRM political
party. Exactly. And they are doing it because, from my evaluation as a political observer, the CRM political party is rising. It's rising and rising every day. So the CPDM is now afraid that they may overtake and enter the National Assembly and overtake the whole political landscape in Cameroon to the detriment of the CPDM. That is why they want to clamp down on them, and to do it, they are using the 2014 terrorism law to suppress people who were exercising their constitutional right.
Now, there have been calls within the national territory from politicians, from civil society leaders, calling on the President of the Republic and, of course, the Cameroon government to liberate Professor Maurice KAMTO and the others. And now the call is coming from outside, from superpowers, the United States of America, through the Undersecretary in charge of African Affairs, and, of course, the European Union through its representative, who are calling for the liberation of Professor Maurice KAMTO and the others. Do you think this cause can prosper?
Listen, as a call for negotiations as a result of the Anglophone war, the war that Mr. Pierre declared on Anglophones, the calls came from all over the world. Has he respected any? Well, let's wait and see. The Undersecretary for African Affairs is coming here on the 17th. Let's see what it will produce. But I hope we are not making it sound like this Professor KAMTO's matter is more serious than the war that has been fought in the Northwest and Southwest, the war declared on us by Mr. Bia. I hope not.
Right now, we're going to take the press review in for me, Armstrong Sander. And when we come back, we're going to talk about the situation in the Northwest and Southwest regions of the country.
Eden newspaper opened the week with the Nigeria court's order for the return of Amazonian leaders. The Post reported that Abuja court's verdict put Cameroon and Nigeria on a legal and diplomatic tight spot. The paper went further to report a massacre in Takija and Nwenti in the northwest region of Cameroon, Logidion, Sisiko and Co. to be compensated and returned to Nigeria. The Star, violation of human rights, judges order Nigeria government to pay Sisiko AYUK TABE and nine others 5 million naira each. The same paper said beer prices go up after years of debate between government and brewery industries in Cameroon. The Median said Amazonian separatists welcome increase in beer prices by brasseries. The Advocate said Amazonian leaders go to court March 7, despite Nigeria High Court's ruling. The Garden Post reported that Sisiku AYUK TABE and Co. have written a tear-provoking letter from prison. The same story appeared on The Voice, which said Amazonian leaders issue manifesto from jail. The Voice further talked about massacre, targeted killings, gendarmes parade naked amber boys, amber avengers hit back as some of the features of the war in the northwest and southwest regions. The Horizon said Tumi's AGC is in a limbo and another group has been formed to arrest the Anglophone crisis. Logidion Echo Trends carried a story on war and environment, describing Northwest and Southwest as an ecological time bomb. The Sun newspaper explained why Sase College is shutting down. The Garden Post, Anglophone crisis, KAMTO detention, fireworks feared as Trump's envoy expected in Yaoundé. In another issue, it cited Trump's envoy, saying Biya's long rule is major cause of Cameroon's troubles.
Thanks for me. I'm Strong Sander for the press review. Barrister Fru Johnson, we're going to start with the situation of your clients. I'm talking about Sisiku AYUK TABE and the other nine Anglophone leaders.
Correct.
Who have been detained in Yaoundé. They have appeared in the military court for quite a number of times now, and until now, what has moved? Has anything changed? Has anything moved an inch?
Nothing has moved an inch because we have put together a defense, a solid defense of legal minds, both in the northwest and southwest, some from Douala, some from Yaoundé. And we have been following the procedure legally. I want to inform you that up to now, they have not been arraigned before that court, because they have no reason to be tried in this country, because they are refugees and asylum seekers in Nigeria. So we have kept the court at bay up to now. All the court appearances, the judge has been looking for all loopholes to arraign them. It will not happen in this court as long as we are in that court, because how do you leave this country, go and connive with a foreign country, capture refugees that are illegally in that country, and bring them here without any due process, and you are trying them in a military court to kill them? How is that possible?
Even though government told us that there was extradition.
I don't know what they call extradition. Nigeria does not have an extradition treaty with Cameroon. There was no due process in Nigeria. If you take a good look at the judgment coming from the Federal High Court in Abuja, you will see that these people's fundamental rights were violated.
We'll be coming to that.
Yes, but I want to tell you that from the day this matter started here in the military tribunal, we have series of objections, limine litis, that is preliminary objections, to raise. We have just finished one. And that is on the nationality issue. We will go on to the very competence of this court to try them.
And on the nationality issue, the court ruled that they are Cameroonians, that they are going to be tried as Cameroonians.
That is what we have gone and appealed for. Even though the court claimed that it was not a ruling, we take it for a ruling. The court, the military court, started saying, "Oh, c'est un mention." I don't know what it is. What is mention in civil law? I've been practicing civil law here for more than 30 years. What is mention? You receive evidence from both sides. You go and come back and issue a ruling, and you say it's not a ruling. It's a mention. What does that mean? So we take it for a ruling, and we have filed an appeal in the appeals court in the center.
No, how can we understand the fact that in the course of a case, the judge who is handling that case is transferred to another town, to another court? Notably, I'm talking about the judge of the military court who was transferred
to Boya.
The Boya military court.
Yes. Let me tell you, if the intent is to frustrate us, they are shooting the wrong way, because we are ready to go as long as it takes. Our clients are ready to go as long as it takes. But that said, having said that,
is it legally correct?
If you transfer a judge from one court to the other, when the judge sitting on the matter, and that matter has not been taken to the end, the new judge coming will have to start de novo. That is, we'll have to start all over. I want to inform you that we're going to start all over, but we are not going to start, listen to me, we're not going to start all over until the Court of Appeal has heard that appeal that we filed. We are going to make sure that the Court of Appeal hears that appeal that we filed. There are two issues that we filed. We filed an appeal on that is ruling, and we also filed a recusal to recuse that bench, because that judge that has just been transferred was openly biased. And you know why? I'll give you just one of the reasons. He's a victim of the Anglophone crisis. His car was burnt in Boya when he was military judge in Boya. So how do you expect a man like that naturally to be fair? So we have, among other issues, among other things that he has done, like the preventing us from filing an appeal and other things that made us to think that he was biased, we have filed a recusal to remove him and his panel from this case. Fortunately for him, in the interim, he has been transferred. But his panel is still there. We will make sure that that panel does not sit again. A new panel must be constituted.
And the next hearing is coming up on the 29th.
On the 29th of March. Yeah. But I'm suspecting that by 29th of March, we will not have finished in the Court of Appeal. So it will be another adjournment.
All right. And concerning the nationality issue, the Nigerian Federal High Court issued a ruling calling on the government of that country, calling on President Buhari and his government to bring back Sisiku, AYUK, TABE and the other nine
correct
to Nigeria.
Correct. And why, pay them damages.
Why is the court asking, requesting that they should be brought back to Nigeria and pay damages?
Because they were legally in Nigeria as refugees and asylum seekers. And they are protected under an international convention that was promulgated in 1951 and ratified by both Nigeria and Cameroon. Cameroon ratified that international convention for the protection of refugees in 1961. So Cameroon is bound by that convention to respect the refugees in Nigeria. Cameroon and Nigeria are bound by that. So when the soldiers in Nigeria connive with soldiers in Cameroon to kidnap those people, I call it kidnapping, because there was no due process, there was nothing, there was no deportation act, there was nothing. In the Nigeria, which is an English system, the common law system, you must go through the due process of law. What does that mean? You must be arrested with a warrant, you must be tried, and a decision taken to deport you, and under that convention, if you are tried for a crime committed in Nigeria, the court must ask you where you want to go, because the law, that international convention, does not allow you to be sent back to the country from where you are running from. That is, those Cameroonians, they were refugees, not allowed to send you back
to your own country
where you are running from. They will ask you to choose a third country, to choose another country.
But are there some
if you are a security threat. If you are not a security threat, you barely go to prison like any other person. Come out and continue to become a refugee.
When the interests of the states involved, like the case we are talking about, Nigeria and Cameroon, concerned, are there some conditions that could allow the two states, the two governments, to agree on one thing or
no, sir. The two governments cannot agree to violate an international convention. There is no such thing like two countries agreeing to violate a national, international convention that was promulgated after World War II to protect refugees and asylum seekers around the world. It's not only Cameroon. It's not only Nigeria. It's all over the world. You cannot agree to violate that constitution. If you read the judgment coming from Abuja, it cites that convention, it cites the human rights, the law on human rights and people's rights of Africa, as promulgated by the African Union. It cites the fundamental rights of people living in Nigeria, which is enshrined in the constitution. It's a violation of Nigerian constitution. It's a violation of international law, a violation of human rights law.
Is the Federal Republic of Nigeria under pressure for having violated this law?
I would suspect that they are under pressure. Look, that judgment has just been issued. It has been certified.
No, with regards to the way the government of the Republic of Cameroon has been handling this case, do you think that is ruling of the Federal High Court of Nigeria, is it going to produce any fruits?
Of course, it must produce fruits. Let me tell you, the Attorney General of Nigeria, of the Federation of Nigeria, has been served with that judgment. And he has 14 days to decide whether to appeal or to execute. And from my evaluation, the issues in the trial court, that is the Federal High Court, were such that there is no grounds for the Federation, for the Attorney General to appeal. But let's wait and see what he does. If he does not appeal, all he will do is that they will pay these people their damages. The 10 leaders will get 5 million naira each. The 47, because it's not only the 10 leaders, it's a total of 57 people. 47 plus 10, that's 57.
The 10 leaders who
the 10 leaders and the other people who were taken from Taraba State. They are all in Kondenge State.
5 million naira each and the others?
The other ones, 200,000
naira
each.
200,000 naira each.
The government, it's not like here, the government will pay. If it doesn't pay, the lawyer will garnish government accounts and force it to pay. Nigeria will want to ask Cameroon to send back those people that were taken from Nigerian soil, from Abuja, and flown into Cameroon, and they are now being detained in maximum security prison, and they are being tried being court-martialed in the military court in Cameroon. Nigeria will be asking Cameroon to send them back.
And the question
diplomatically,
is, will Cameroon yield to
that? I cannot answer that question.
What will compel Cameroon to yield to that demand?
The world has become a global village. If Cameroon wants to step out of the global village, it can do so. But Nigeria has a duty now to clean its image, because this matter has dirtied the image of Nigerian government. Nigeria is one of the countries, out of two countries in Africa, that are gunning for the permanent member of the Security Council. Because the Security Council has decided that they will increase the permanent members from 5 to 7. One from Africa, one from South America. And in Africa, two countries are gunning for it, South Africa and Nigeria. And if Nigeria does not take this opportunity to clean its image, by asking Cameroon to simply comply to the Federal High Court ruling that has compelled Nigeria to bring those people back, they will have to have a diplomatic problem. And naturally, Nigeria will call on the United Nations.
International law will take preeminence over whatsoever would be decided.
Yes, it will not be international diplomatic problem between Nigeria and Cameroon. We are not yet there. We are waiting to see what the Attorney General will do. But that is what is going to happen. I can assure you that any judgment coming from the Federal High Court in Abuja is taken very seriously by the Nigerian government.
All right. We're going to take interviews of the week right now. And when we come back, we'll go to the northwest and southwest regions of the country.
Of women in the northwest and southwest who are sleeping in the bushes, who are being killed, who are being raped, who have no way to take care of their children. I think people, when you go to northwest and southwest, you see women in tears because they have sat with children in the bush for 2 weeks and have had to have cut leaves to give those children to eat. So we have to stand by those women. We cannot only sit and say, oh, what can we do? It's a horrible situation. This is an opportunity to express to those women that we are with you.
I want to call on the Cameroonian women and the North and Southwest women who came out in their numbers and mourned at the Bongo Square in Boya. They sat down on their buttocks and they wept of what is going through. Here at the stadium, here, Bamenda women went there and wept. And that instead of celebrating this day, let the women sit down and weep and mourn for their husbands, for their children who are being killed. Whether these tears will replace the blood that is flowing, and Sabia will listen.
Celebration is a good thing. And we need to, in society, celebrate women who are not celebrated enough. However, on this particular day, in this particular moment in the life of our nation, we need to protest. We must protest. We must say, no, it's not okay. Not okay that our government lined up two women and a girl and a baby on the back and shot them. And then lied to us and said, no, it was not us. Then finally, when they could no longer lie, it was them, but they are carrying out investigation. No justice till today for those women. If it's only for those two women, that little girl and that baby, we should be in protest.
I am really taken aback. I'm surprised and really beaten, because I think that at the stage where we are in this country, we should do one thing right and one thing with a little bit of human touch and one thing looking at the local woman. I don't know whether the government of Cameroon has really studied the beginning of the Women's Day, where it started, why it started, and how it started, to educate people and to bring the local people, get them involved. As we're talking, in Yaoundé, the Anglophone elites, ministers, directors, secretary generals are contributing 1.5 million each to buy Women's Day uniform to give the IDPs in Yaoundé and Douala. And they do not feel for the woman who is in the bush now, with a 2-3-day-old baby crying under rains in mosquitoes. They are contributing money to buy material gift. I thought that women should have taken this day to press for the solutions of what we are going through. I call on the women to have the sympathy of the other women who are being raped every day.
In Boya, children cannot more go to school because there's no school, there's no way. There's just war everywhere. So I will invite most of the youth to know how the situation is going worse and know through social network how they can play a role in peacemaking.
The youth have a power, and with that power they can strongly contribute to building social cohesion in Cameroon. So because we know that most of them, they have power, but when we look at the social media, for example, they use it instead to send messages of hate. We want them to use this opportunity, their strong power, to rather build peace inside their community. The country has been having so many challenges, security challenges. And when we look at these challenges, we see the youth at the center of this. They perpetrate acts of violence. Each time there is a problem, most of the time we find youth inside all the situations.
Recently, we all witnessed the resignation of our national chairman, Honorable Justice Ayapol Abine. His resignation, it has nothing to do within an issue like an internal squabble of the party. He clearly said it. Politics is not a situation where we have to move on people's blood to take over leadership, policy in a situation where we have to be in a chaotic way that we have people arrested, repression, violence everywhere. We have refugees internally displaced. That is not all about politics. His resignation, those of us who were very close to him did not really take us as a surprise, because he earlier told us about his resignation and earlier said we should start looking for someone to take over the leadership of the party.
We are striking because of the condition of lecturers at the University of Douala. Because since 2 years, we still negotiate with the administration, but with the little result, they offer us staff room for lecturers, but there is not any chair, there is not light, there is not water. And the strike is also concerning the financial aspect. When we used to go to the Yaoundé for the promotion of the lecturers, when we go there, we need to stay to hotel and feed ourselves. But we lecturers used to use our own money without the support of the university. Knowing that for these two aspects, the university have to give a part for just for the transportation or the accommodation. But until now, since 2 years, we went there without any accommodation coming from the university. We meet the dean of the different and the head of faculty of the different school. They say that the administration take 20 million for each school to ameliorate the condition of lecturers, but until now we don't have any amelioration. Just we can just have the Faculty of Science, the Faculty of Economic Science, who have a little amelioration. But Faculty of Letters and Faculty of Public Law, there is not any amelioration. It's lecturers who are trying to ameliorate the space they give to them. It's not normal.
If we are out today, it is because most of our rights as support staffs are being violated by this present regime. I'm making reference to vice chancellors and rectors of Cameroon State University, because we have noticed that any decree, be it presidential decree or prime ministerial decree, or any law that accords some certain advantages to support staffs, those laws are being relegated to the background as far as support staffs are concerned. A prime ministerial decree number 2014/2217/PM of the 24th of July 2014. This prime ministerial decree increases the minimum wage that is supposed to be received by every worker within the nation to the sum of 36,270 francs. But almost 5 years later, can you imagine that a support staff that has been recruited on category 1, echelon 1, still has as basic salary 25,087 francs. It is very deplorable.
The strike of my personnel, Mr. Tipo Soler, we have been dealing about the matters. This matter deals, first of all, with the increase of what is called in French, SMIC. I mean, the basic salary, official basic salary, authorized in our country, which has been raised from 25,000 francs CFA to 36,500, I think, francs CFA, something like that. Okay. Now, the personnel are requesting to see application, complete application of this, of so said decree of the head of government, prime minister. Okay, so we have done the necessary to upgrade the potential salary, which probably might be less than 36,000. So we have dealt with a problem, and you have no problem with that anymore today. But the second point of claims of my personnel was they were not concerned with reduction of salaries made in 1993 by the government. They are claiming that they should not be included to those to be applied this reduction of salary. I said, okay, I don't know why you pretend that you are not concerned.
We have big lorries carrying sand, serving the new stadium in construction. That's why you find holes in the way. That a hole, if I enter a hole there, you cannot even see my head. At least we try to fill those gutters, those holes by our human activities every Sunday morning. But it appears that those efforts are not sufficient because rain, with all this natural problem, we cannot cope with it. We need more materials. We need the support of government. Many who have their money, they are fleeing the quarter to go and stay back in the towns.
I would not say that the Kribi port functions 100%. This could be a lie. But what I can say is that since almost 1 year, this functioning is upgrading day by day. And we are doing everything to improve the competitiveness of this port. Economic operators cannot just run to Kribi without this information. I think it's important for us to come and meet them and tell them that Kribi is already functioning. And tell them also about the opportunities the Kribi port can give to them.
In a recent statement on the prevailing situation in the northwest and southwest regions of the country, the European Union representative Federica Mogherini indicated, I quote, "The persistence of violence and human rights violations in the northwest and southwest regions of Cameroon has resulted in an unacceptable number of casualties and a heavy impact in humanitarian and economic terms." And the Under Secretary of State of the United States of America in charge of African Affairs equally indicated in an outing on Radio France International that the Cameroon government was not serious enough in handling this crisis. When you look at these two statements, what can you say about international involvement in the ongoing situation in the Northwest and Southwest regions?
We thank God that the international community is now getting involved in this horrible war that Mr. Abia brought on our people. What do I mean by that? The war has been fought now for 2 years counting, almost 3 years. It is now the international community is getting up. I want to add that the European Union is also, to 27 members have reacted. And I am saying that the matter is getting serious against this government. If I was advising this government, I would not advise the so-called Minister of Communication to issue a communique condemning what the Undersecretary for African Affairs of the United States of the State Department said. He should have just waited for him to come, and they handled it diplomatically. Now he has made it confrontational. So the man is supposed to be here on the 17th. This is the first time the international community is reacting positively towards this horrible war that is taking the lives of our people, destroying our villages, destroying our fabric. The whole of Northwest now is torn apart. If I tell you the number of casualties, it's horrible. The villages that have been burnt down, and the military arsenal that the Cameroon government is moving to the Northwest and Southwest as if they are fighting a foreign country. Now we now know that they are fighting a foreign country.
And the statement of the EU representative is in sharp contrast to what we have been hearing some persons, including some authorities, who have been telling us that the situation is gradually returning to normalcy, is under control.
It is so a sharp contrast.
She says the situation is unacceptable.
It's unacceptable. And it has been unacceptable for the last 3 years. The international community, you know, things grind very slowly, but they are getting there. For the first time, these people are now, their backs are to the wall, because they have been telling everybody lies that the situation is under control. What do they mean by situation under control? When children are dying, women are dying, men are dying, civilians, ordinary civilians who have nothing to do with the war are being shot every day by the Cameroon military. They go into the villages, they just shoot at random and kill civilians.
Even though the Ministry of Defense has repeatedly said it in statements, notably indicating that the military is not there to kill. The military is there to protect the people and the properties, is there to protect the territorial integrity of Cameroon, and not to kill and not to destroy properties and so on.
Jonathan, we are in a global village. The imageries are there. The atrocities committed by this military is there. For the Ministry of Defense and the Minister of Communication can say whatever they want to say, but the facts on the ground are there. Look at what happened in Bali. Look at what happened is happening in Kumbu. Look at what is happening even in Bamenda town, in the suburbs of Bamenda town. Look at what is happening in the Southwest province. They started in Manfe. You saw what happened in Kembong and other places. Kwakwa in Kumba, on the Kumba-Bonge road. Look, the imageries are there. All the burnings of both hospitals, schools, and villages have been orchestrated by the military. I'm not going to start arguing. There will be an investigation, international investigation, and we will see the atrocities that this government and its military has committed on the people of the Northwest and Southwest. I don't want to call them the Northwest and Southwest, because it is getting clear that they will no longer be Northwest and Southwest.
And accusing fingers of the Yaoundé administration are pointing to the separatists to have committed this.
Listen to me, Joseph. Listen to me. Yes, I understand that.
District hospital.
Yes. Let me
questions on how hospitals, or a hospital like the Kumba District Hospital, is set ablaze to that extent, despite the military presence and so on. But then the national president, or the president of the National Commission on Human Rights and Freedoms, in his last statement on this issue, highlighted this problem of identifying who did what. And he was worried and questioning why. What is the problem that it cannot be identified? Those who are committing the crimes cannot be identified, and
there is no political will to identify. And I want to tell you that my analysis is that the military did it. Because I, as a young man at the age of 22, I worked in that hospital. It's a very well constructed British hospital that they left in Kumba. Very well constructed with stones. For that kind of destruction to take place, it has to be professional. The restoration forces don't have the capacity to do that. And they cannot shoot themselves in the foot, burn a hospital where some of them are being treated. That hospital has been treating wounded people from both sides. And what happened is that there was a battle between the army and the restoration forces in Kumba. And some of those boys were wounded. And the military thought that they would be taken to that hospital. So they ran to that hospital and went to the outpatient and asked the doctor and the nurses to produce a list of patients. They said they refused to. It's against medical ethics. We will not do that. Secondly, fire brigade. I know Kumba very well. I know that's clear. Well, the fire brigade is not up to 2 minutes away from there. And Ajudan in that fire brigade declared that the military stopped them from intervening in that fire. So who burned the hospital?
The Yaoundé administration has continued, you know, dismissing those allegations and accusing.
Well, they can't. They are satellite images.
Now, the U.S. Secretary, Under Secretary for African Affairs, said the Cameroon government has to take serious measures. What are some of those serious measures that you think the government has to take to solve this crisis as quick as possible?
The only serious measure is that we sit on the negotiating table. I don't see any other way of coming out of it. And if they don't want to sit on the table, that's fair and good for us. When I mean us, I mean the Northwest and Southwest. I'm from the Northwest and Southwest, the part that has been at that Mr. Beer declared war on. We are sitting on the negotiating table. That is a serious measure.
That
is what everybody has been asking for. Because we cannot live under this condition. We don't have villages again. You go to Bali now, Bali is a war zone. You cannot go back to your village right now as I'm talking to you.
All right, Barrister Fru Jamso, lead defense counsel of the Anglophone leaders being detained in Yaoundé, member of the Cameroon Bar Association. Thanks for coming.
For now, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's it for this edition of The Inside. Thanks for staying with us. Goodbye.